Kulin, page 63, we are five lines from the top of the page. It's always amazing to see connection between the Torah portion, the biblical chapter of the week, and the daily study. The Torah tells us the mitzvah of leaving the leftover non-kosher meat to the dog. The rabbis ask why we are commanded to leave it for the dog. The famous explanation, it's because when our people left Egypt, the dog did not bark. So in a way, the Almighty, everything does injustice, and therefore He asked us, commanded us, to leave basar basadet treifa, leftover meat, to our dogs. But obviously there is way more, and today we're going to talk about different birds, kashruyot, what is under the list of pure, not pure, and why, and we're going to expand on that. The well-known editor and author, in part, of the Mishnayot, Rabbi HaKadosh, Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih, he put together the oral teaching, the Mishnah, and one of the well-known statement is, Almighty God, it was well-known before you, all the list of kosher birds, which are many, versus the Torah put the list of non-kosher birds, as we learned day before yesterday and yesterday, of 24 non-kosher birds. Why is that? Because the succinct, the short, the terse, the abbreviation of the learning is the best way to convey message, especially sacred message. And if you look at the oral teaching, everything is clear, succinct, and to the point. Now, we are expanding on different specific birds, and we are, as we said, page 63, five lines from the top of the page, we are dealing with a bird called shalach. So the Amar Rav Yehuda, shalach ze hasholet dagim min hayam. He said that the shalach, which is a type of a non-kosher bird, is a bird that scoops fish out of the sea. Now, the rabbis expand on that. Some call it shalinuna. Duchifat shehodo kafut. So the duchifat, that's in Vayikra, Leviticus 11, verse 19. The bird whose cum seems bent because it's his thickness. Now, in a way, the shalach is prohibited for consumption, and the duchifat, it's a different version. If it's shalach, most of the rabbis said that what we call today orev hamayim or cormoran, it's very similar to saknai, which we're going to learn later. So when it's come to a duchifat, some say that it's a tavah sabar. We mentioned many times there is an excellent book called Sichat Chulin, obviously in the Hebrew, that expand and give us all the variation, what most probably is all about. Tanya Namayachi, listen to this. This is really fascinating. They said, duchifat shehodo kafut, וזהו שהביא שמיר לבית המקדש. When they built our holy temple, the first one, the main architect, builder, and more, was the son of David and Bathsheba, Shlomo, Solomon. And one of the conditions the Torah tells us, לא תניף עליהן ברזל, or כל כלי ברזל לא נשמע בבית ביבנותו. They said in the book of Kings, Chapter 6, that it wasn't any type of iron vessel, and more to some can say because of the noise, some said because of the using these tools. It was all in our language, spiritual, sacred, including the structure of the building itself. So since they have a large stones, how they were able to cut those stones? So they said that it was that bird called Duchifat, which is the, as we said earlier, whose kam seems bent. And that's the bird that brought the Shamir. Shamir is a tolaat, is some type of small creature, the Beit HaMikdash, the holy, first holy temple. They say more on that if you click on our learning tractate Zvachim, page 68b, we expand on that. The idea is that Shamir was the one who's able, was the special God-given capability to cut. You put that small animal on the large stones and they cut it, and they cut it straight. Amazing. So as we explained, the Gemara in Gittin tells us that King Solomon required a unique worm that it's called Shamir to carve stones of the Beit HaMikdash, of the Holy Temple. And that's based on the Pasuk. They said in the Book of Kings, chapter 6, verse 7, there was neither hammer nor axe nor any tool of iron heard in the house while it was in building. Rabbi Yochanan Keava Chazei Shalach Amar Mishpatecha Tehom Rabba. Rabbi Yochanan, when he sees Shalach, he will say what King David said in the Book of Psalm, chapter 36, your judgment are like the great deep, which means the Almighty, exact retribution even upon the fish in the sea. Meaning, the rabbis tells us that even the animals pass to judgment, mainly in their interaction to people, to human. As we mentioned earlier, example with the dog, when we have the mitzvah to leave the meat, nevelot, refot, because they are quiet when dog are quiet when we left Egypt. The donkey, we have a special mitzvah since they carry. When we left Egypt, they have the mitzvah of Peter Chamor, the firstborn, and more. So here you see, the Mefarshim said, you see the shalach, that bird. And you see it, if you watch sometimes the water, they get to the fish, pull the fish from the water. So it's kind of the chosen fish, and why and how is that Mishpatecha Tom Rabba, that's the Almighty judgment, even in the great deep, even those animals in the water. God is the omnipresent, and it's all, we believe, in justice. Ki hava chazei nemala, when he saw an ant, he was saying the same verse, Amar tzidkatecha, tzidkatcha keharerei el. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. As the Creator, the Almighty God, provides sustenance for this tiny, minute ant, as justice he does for larger creatures. And if you analyze the Mefarshim said, you see Rashi on them of his teachers, you have two explanations. He says one of them that God provided for the ant this small, almost bug, food all the time. So that it's ready to door. God helped the ants to have the food saved from one winter to the summer and vice versa. It's all set up with kindness of God. As the Gemara by the end of Kiddushin said, and we should remember that none of those animals have a college degree, yet many of them has the food ready for them when needed. Amar ha-meimar, laknei uvatnei sharyan, shaknei uvatnei makom shenagu lechol ochlim, מקום שנהגו שלא לאכול, אין אוכלים. So he said this type of לקני ותני allowed to eat. שקנאי, there is a few versions, if it's a שע או סע, and ותנאי, we are not sure exactly. The Aruch HaShalem tried to give us idea who are they. But anyway, according to the place that they have the tradition to, the custom to eat, they eat. Those would not, that's the important again of the Masoret. Rabbeinu Asher, the Rosh, expand on that in one of his Tshuva, how important it is to keep the Masoret, what Chachmei Ashkenaz have from one generation to another, and to stick with their Masoret. But anyway, Makom Shenagu Lechol Ochlim, Makom Shenagu Shelo Lechol En Ochlim, you go by the custom. So there is a place that is customary not to eat them, for example, why may not eat them? So Gemara asks, Atu b'min haga talya milta? You meant to say that the place where they are forbidden is a place that depend upon the custom? So the Gemara said, Ein, yes. Velokashya, ha be'atra deshchichei peres vozniya, ha be'atra shelo, delo shchichei peres vozniya. This place that they are forbidden is a place where the peres and vozniya are found. Since they are familiar to these birds, one must be concerned that people will confuse them, even though this type of Sharyan, Batnae, themselves kosher. That place that they are permitted is the place where the person who's near are not found. So the Maharam Shiv, so they say that it's close to the desert. It's not so much in a place of inhabitants. Tosfot challenge that. Where exactly they found it, and how you concern, and when you concern, one is welcome to see you at this fort here. But anyway, Amar Abaye, Ku'ei ve kaku'ei asirei kaku'ata sharia. B'marav ha'malku ilavei, in Eretz Israel, in the West, they flag one who eats it on its account, ve'karula tachvata. So in Eretz Yisrael, they prohibit it, and they call it Tachvata. So they, in the era of the Enlightenment, the era of the Maskilim, it was those that challenged the rabbi in regards to the chicken. They said that if you look at the way that they move and the raise and they do, the whole concept of simanim, how you recognize them, what's the difference in why we allow some and not to allow others. But early on, much earlier, at the era of the Ibn Ezra, he brings a lot of proofs that when it's come to Tarnegolet, the chicken is the Masoret, the whole discussion is when you do not have the Masoret, you do not have the tradition. So, therefore, like we discussed yesterday and day before yesterday, Turkey, Tarnegol, Hodu, and the same is the discussion with animals, behemoth, when you do not have the Masoret. Tanu Rabbanan Tinshemet. So, here, the rabbis talk about Tinshemet, listed in the Torah as a non-kosher, in Leviticus chapter 11, verse 18. So there are two types of tinshemet. One is a bird, and one is the creeping animal, sherets. So some say that it's the bird that is called kos. Some say that it's like atalef. But anyway, bavat shebaufot. Bavat shebaufot. So it's the bavat among the bird. It's the name of a bird. Ata omer bavat shebaufot olana bavat shebasrashim, as we said that there are two types of tinshemet. Tse ulmad mishlosh medot ra shel nedresh ben dvar leminyano. As we learn many times in the Rabbi Ishmael 13 principle, one of them is you learn from its context. So we have 13 hermeneutical principles. So one of them is a matter derived from its context. So since the context, במה הכתוב מדבר? בעופות. It speaks about what? About birds. אף כאן בעופות. So the same here, the word tinchemet is referred to birds, not to shratim, the creeping animal. Tanya Rameyachi, shratim kehai gavna. It's also taught in a braita. So tinchemet, as we said earlier, there are two tinchemet. One is the ofod, the birds, and the other one is listed among the creeping animals, the shratzim. So here, the one we speak here is bavat shebashratzim. So it's bavat among those creeping animals. And as we said earlier, there is Sichat Chulin, Ma'or leMasechet Chulin, many other books that try to point it out what exactly it means. Ata omer bavat shebashratzim, or nola bavat shebaofot. Maybe it's the one not among the creeping animals, but among the birds. Amar tatzeulmad mishlosh esrim midos shatuhan dreshet b'hem. So we learn from the 13 hermeneutical principles for which the Torah derives, as we said every day, from Rabbi Ishmael. Davar alamed midyano, b'me devarim, b'me akadu medaber, bishratzim, afkan bishratzim. The same way as the concept, the context, to talk about creeping animals. So here too, the word in Shemitz is referring to creeping animals. And for those who are not 100% familiar, the idea of the principle, something learned from his context, a simple example is thou shall not steal. It's a common mistake over the years. I saw it a lot, that people think that, oh, thou shall not steal is the Ten Commandments. And because the rabbi said that you go by the context, the context speak about capital punishment. Thou shall not commit murder, thou shall not commit adultery, etc. So it's all part of the capital punishment. The rabbi is derived from that, that the commandment of lo tignov, you shall not steal in the Ten Commandments, applies because of its context to kidnapping. Versus in Leviticus, when they use the word lo tignov, they add the letter vav, lo tignovu. Over there, this speaks about monetary compensation, they're dealing with a treating employees properly, paying wages on time and more, all involved with in the context with monetary compensation, and therefore over there it's applied to money, not in the Ten Commandments. So again, that's part of application of this concept here, which is called davar halamed miyano, something that you derive from its context. Amar Abaye, Bavat sheba'ofot kipof, bavat sheba'shratzim kupedai. So here it says bavat among birds, it's called kipof. So, and Tosfot expand on that. What is the one among the birds? What is among the creeping animals? He expand a lot, Tosfot, all different species. But anyway, it's oftame or sheretz tame, non-pure bird or creeping animal. Amar Rav Yehuda ka'at zo hakuk. Some say that is saknai. Racham zo shrakrak. Amar Rabbi Yochanan lama nikra shmo racham. Why it's called the word racham, which means mercy. Kevan sheba racham ba'u rachamim la'olam. Since that one came to the world, so the compassion, the mercy, come upon the world. So the Maharsha explains that this animal is come and it basically create these sounds that brings rain, bring blessing of abundance of rain. Amar Rav Bibi bar Abaye, v'udi ativ ve'amidei ve'avid shrakrak. So that's a sign of rain when it sits on something and makes a sounds, a shrakrak sound. So again, what exactly and how exactly they are doing that? The Sichat Chulin, many others try to explain, but Rashi tells us here, Ugmirei di ativ ha-ra'a v'shayir. Rik ata meshicha shenemar shrika lahem ba'kabtzem. So he said based on the prophecy of Zechariah, chapter 10, verse 8, the pasuk, the verse said, I will hiss for them and gather them, which speaks about the end of the days, the Messianic era. So therefore, it Rashi explained that it's a good news, a good a sign. So when you see the bird makes this rak-rak sound and sit on the ground, which is very uncommon for that bird, and hisses, that's the sign that the end of the day. And the Chatam Sofer in Yoreh Ayin Dalet, and you see it also in Lev Aryeh, based on Perek Shira, they expand a lot what exactly it means. Torat Chaim said that that's not the Derech HaOfot, it's very uncommon. Amar Le Rav Ada Bar Shimi, Amar Bar Rav Idai, Veha Ahu Deativ Bei Kracha, Vesharak, Veata Galal Afsekei Lemochei. So here bring an example that it was a certain Racham that set on the plow field and hissed, and a stone came and broke its head. So they said, Amar Le Ahu Baidava. That Racham was a liar and was punished for his prophesying falsely. So that's the reason. Some said it wasn't really Racham. The Maharal tried to explain what is a mystical meaning of that. Tanu Rabbanan. Orev ze orev. So as we learned yesterday and the day before yesterday, in general we try to say that that's the crow. But we struggle throughout the sugiyot if that's really the crow. But anyway, El kol orev leavi orev ha'amki. Lemino lavi orev abba berashei yonim. So the one is including valley crow, and the other one is include the crow that comes at the head of the pigeon. Amar mar orev ze orev. Atu kaman kai. So it means it stands before us, such as that we know immediately which one it is. Elaima orev ze orev ukama. It's a black crow. That's the one we know from the Song of Songs, chapter 5. וכן אומר, קבוצותיו טלטלים שחורות כעורב. Obviously, it's a figurative expression, but King Solomon in the Song of Songs said that the valley crow is his locks are curls and belly as a crow. העמקי חברה, וכן אומר, ומראהו עמוק מן האור. So they amki, that's the valley cow, the white crow, and the pasuk said about leprosy. They said in Leviticus 13, if it's apparent thereof be a deeper than the skin. Kemarech ha'amuka min atzel. The sages explain is the appearance of an area lit by the sun, which seemed deeper than the shade. Which appears to cover it. So it's an association between a valley and a color white. Ve'orev abba b'rashei yonim, and the crow that comes the head of the pigeon, amar Rav Papa lo teima de'ate b'reish yonei ele de'damei l'reish lidyona. So he said that do not say that the brighter means that it's come at the head of a pigeon, which is it dwell with them. Rather it means that this crow head resembles that of a pigeon. There's a lot of Midrashic writings. Some say that they speak about cruelty of the crow. And they said is that's a person that not support his children, his family. There are many rabbis that see it in a positive way, in a sense that the Orev Shachor, the black crow, when the children come up, the babies come out, they are white and he's not recognizing them. And only when they grew up, he have mercy on them because he recognized them as his children. But anyway, Tanu Rabbanan. Hanetz ze hanetz, the Leviticus 11 verse 16, then the nets, after its kind, the seller said the nets, that this is the hawk. Leminehu, after its kind, leavi et bar chir ya. So include the bird called bar chir ya. My bar chir ya. The Gemara asks, what exactly you mean by saying bar chir ya? So here we have Abaye, Amar Abaye. At the time of Abaye, it's called Shurinka. That's the bird common name. We do not know for sure. There is a book called Toldot Haaretz and Pirush Rabbi David Zvi Hoffman, the book of Vayikra, that tried to explain what is it all about. Some said it is a Chankan. Anyway, in Rav Steinzel's Gemara, he expanded on that too. אמר רב יהודה, חסידה זו דיה לבנה. למה נקרא שמה חסידה? What's the reason for that name? שעושה חסידות עם חברותיה, that she is kind, perform charity, חסיד, piety, חסידה, with its her fellow, which she share with other birds, their own food. הענפה זו דיה רגזנית, that's a irritable דיה. ולמה נקרא שמה ענפה? Why it's called ענפה? ענף, one פירוש שמנעפת עם חברותיה. Some say that it crawls with its fellows, like it ענף בי. There are others who, like the חידושי ערים, the girl rabbi ask a question, if you tell me that the חסידה עושה חסד, they do kindness, so why it's off tame, why it's a non-kosher bird? And he explained that only with chavroteah, only the animal, the bird does chasadim, does act of piety and kindness, but that only to the segregated, excluded, close friends, not with others. There are other explanations that it's a selfish act, because or whatever it served her, and that's the chasadim, it's from a selfish motivation, not from the sincere altruism and intent to help others. אמר רב חנן בר רב חיסדא, אמר רב חיסדא, אמר רב חנן ברי דרבה, אמר רב 24 עופות טמאים. That's what we said many times, that there are 24 non-kosher birds. אמר לרב חנן בר רב חיסדא, לרב חיסדא, דהיכה. He said, from where in the Torah this number obtained? So he said, אי דוויקרא, if you go by Leviticus chapter 11, 20 אבו, there are only 20. אי דמשנה תורה, if you go by the book of Deuteronomy, פרשת ראה, chapter 14, 21 הבו, the sages enumerate them, and there are only 21. וכי תימא דעה דכתיבה בויקרא, ולא כתיבה משנה תורה שדיה להו. If you add דעה, which is written in the book of Leviticus, but not in Deuteronomy, to others in Deuteronomy, still there are only 22, הקראת 20 וטרן אהבו, אמר לי רב חיסדא סד, תו רב חנן, היסן, הכי כמה רבו המשמי דשמח רב, דרב, that's name of רב, that's למינה, דיסד לבדיקוס 11, למינה, למינו, למינהו, הרי כאן ארבע. So they use the term, after its kind, after its kind, four times. It's appeared, each list indicate additional cases. So he said, יחי 20 ושית הבו. If that's the case, you enumerate 22 plus 4 is 26, not 24. So אביה respond, אמר אביה, דעה וראה אחתי. What the Torah said in Leviticus chapter 11, verse 14, the word ראה, and change the ראש, to דלת, it said דעה, with Dalet, and then change it to Reish in Deuteronomy 14, verse 13, Achati, it's the same one, it's a one bird. The Isalka datach tarteninu, if it's entered to your mind that there are two different birds. 63b, Michdei Mishne Torah lo sufe udeata. So, because the list is in the book of Dvarim in Deuteronomy, so, and in a way it's come to add to the list of Leviticus, Da'a and Ra'a is a two different type. Ma'ishna ha'cha dechtiv Da'a, u'ma'ishna ha'cha dechtiv Ra'a, Dalet, Reish, Da'a, Ra'a, v'lo chtiv Da'a, ela shma mina, min Ra'a, v'da'a achati. So in conclusion here the Gemara said that the present here applies to only one species, and it's part of the non-kosher bird. So they might ask, if that's the case, ve'akate 25 havu, so there's a 25 non-kosher birds in this list, not 24. Amar Abaye, Abaye respond and answer, kishem shera'a v'da'a achati, kach aya v'da'a achati, aya v'daya achati. Same way as reish and aleph, ra'a, daya is the same one, the same way is ayah in Daya, Aleph and Dalet, it's one. The Yisachar Atach Tartei Ninun, if you tell me that too, Mikhdei Mishne Torah, the same Malach, this Mishne Torah, Lo Sufi Udeata, Maishnaach Adichtiv Lemina Aya, or Maishnaatam Dichtiv Lemina Adaya, Elashma Mina Aya, Veda'a, Achati. So do you see that both of them are the same, which means that when you use the term Lemina in the Book of Dvarim, Deuteronomy, that's applied to Daya. וכי מאחר שהיה ודעה אחת היא, since the היה and דעה are one species, the question is, למה למכתב היה ודעה? So why did the Torah need to write both היה and דעה in Deuteronomy? כדתניה רבי אומר, so they said this, the writer רבי יהודה הנשיא says, אקרא אני היה. It is true that it's enough to say what we learn in the book of, derived from the book of Deuteronomy, היה. ודיה למה נאמרה? כדי שלא תיתן ביטחון בלה, בעלין לחלוק. שלא תהיה אתה קורא היה, והוא קורא לו דיה. So in order to avoid any misunderstanding, people that try to claim to litigants and to disagree and to make something that's not correct by misconstruing the text on purpose, vice versa, אתה קורא דיה, הוא קורא לו היה, לכך תחל משנה תורה, הרעה ואת הדיה והדיה למינה, in order to make sure that there is no misunderstanding, that all carries the same one. תוספות challenge that, and he said that it's to make sure, again, it's the same מהלך, that to make sure that is the same, that both the least in Leviticus and that in Deuteronomy enumerate 24 births according to the statement attribute to Rab. Meiti ve'lama nishnu bivheima bivheima mipnei ha'shesua ube'of mipnei ha'ra'a. So why is the list of a non-kosher animal in Leviticus repeated? It is due to a necessity of adding the shesua in Deuteronomy 14, verse 7, which was not listed in Leviticus. Ubeofot mipnei ra'a, and list of non-kosher bird is repeated due to the ra'a. Ma'ilav divheima da'atam lo'osufe, ofot name lo'osufe. Again, to avoid misunderstanding, to add animal there, and to add the list of birds there, so the Gemara responds, lo hatam lo'osufe achal ferushe, with regard to any animals, the list is repeated to add, but here with regard to a bird, it's repeated only to explain. Upligi de Rabbi Abau. So here we say that, yes, Rav's hold that is 24 non-kosher birds, but Rabbi Abau disputed that. Da'amar Rabbi Abau ra'a zo aya. ולמה נקרא שמה רעה שרואה ביותר, וכן הוא אומר, נתיב לא ידעו עית, ולא שזפתו אין היה. So that's a pasuk in the book of Job. They said that path of no bird of prey known. Neither has the eye of היה seen it. תנה, עומדת בבבל ורואה נבלה בארץ ישראל. So the ra'ah standing in Babylon and see a carcass, a dead body in the ארץ ישראל. So some said עומדת כאן and said disagree. What exactly it means? Anyway. So now the Gemara discusses Rabbi Abahu's statement. They said מדרעה אינו היה מכלל דדעה עליו היינו רעה. ניסי מלאך, מכדי משנה תורה לא סופי ודעתה. מה ישנה אחת הכתיב דעה ומה ישנה אתם דלא כתיב דעה? אלא לב שממינה דעה ורעה והיה אחת היא. So it's all the same, it's one species. ומדרעה היינו היה, מכלל דדעה עליו היינו היה. So from the fact that Rabbi Abahu holds that רעה is the same as היה, by inference one may conclude that דדעה is not the same as היה. מה ישנה אתם לכתיב למינה, היה, מה שנה אחת לכתיב למינה, היה אלא הדיה. In Leviticus, it's written after its kind, about the Ayah. And it's, what is different here in Deuteronomy, that is written after its kind, about the Ayah, but about the Dayah. Gemara said, אלא שמה מינה דעה ורעה ודעה אחת היא. So it's all one species, and consequently, according to Rabbi Abao, there are only 23 non-kosher species. Tanya Isi ben Yehuda אומר, מאה עופות מאים יש במזרח וכולן מן היהן. So he used the term מאה. Question is, מאה מן מאה? Anyway, but he said that in the eastern part, there's a the 100 non-kosher birds, and they're all species of Aya. Tani avi mibred Rabbi Abao, 700 minei dagim. You have 700 species of fish that are not kosher. Hen, ushmone mot minei chagavim. And there are 800 type of non-kosher grasshopper. Uleofot el mispar, and a countless birds. So the Gemara said, wait a second, ofot 24 avu. We said earlier from Rav that there are only 24 non-kosher birds. Ela uleofot tehorim en mispar. They said that the Rabbi Abao must have meant that there are countless kosher birds. Tane Rabbi Omer galui v'yado ifne mishamar v'ayolam shebemat meat merubah min ha-Torah. This is fascinating. They said, revealed known before the Almighty God, the creator of the world, one who spoke and the world came to being, that the species of non-kosher animal are more numerous than the kosher ones. And consequently, lefichach mana kadu b'Torah. So that's the reason why the Torah listed kosher animal, teaching that all the rest are non-kosher. Galui v'yodol lefne mishamar av olam shofot torim merubim alat meim, lefichach mana matam betmeim. Maika mashmelan. What's the reason that they do that? Gemara said, "Kid Ravuna Amarav, Amr La Amaravuna, Amarav Mishmar Rabbi Meir, Leolam Mishna La Mitamido Derech Ktzara." We derive from that, as we said in the Akdam and introduction, that the person should always teach his disciples, his students, in a concise manner, meaning to be very succinct, very short to the point, just as Torah is concise in its language. אמר רבי יצחק עוף טהור נאכל במסורת. רבי יצחק said that the kosher bird may eat in the strength of a tradition that is kosher. נאמן הצייד לומר עוף זה טהור מסר לי רבי. We trust the hunter that is credible to say that my teacher conveyed to me that his bird is kosher. אמר רבי יוחנן והוא שבקי בהם ובשמותיהם. רבי יוחנן said that his condition, as long as he is erudite, is very familiar with a non-kosher bird and their names. ביי רבי זרע רבו חכם. O Rabbo Tzayad, Rabbi Zera raised a predicament. His quandary is, was Rabbi Yochanan referring to the hunter, the teacher, the sages, or his teacher, the hunter, which is the one who taught him how to hunt. Tashma d'amar Rabbi Yochanan, v'ushibaki b'ayim b'shmotem, I amar b'shlama Rabbo Tzayad Shafir, elah emart Rabbo Chacham b'shlama shmayu gamir leor, inu miyadalu. So you know many times when the Gemara repeats Shema Mina, it means the final conclusion. And they said that Rabbi Yochanan referred to his teacher, the hunter, and that's the final conclusion. The Yamshu Shlomo and the Shach comment on that, and they said, you know, the reality is that we are living in a generation that we are not really familiar with different type of birds, so therefore we cannot mati, we cannot permit it based on the hunter, only by the masoret, by the tradition. And that's basically what Rabbeinu Asher, the Rosh, said. Just few words of the Rosh. שאלות ותשובות כלל כף סימן כף. So he bring all the masoret for those about Hasidah, etc. He said, דק כי אני לא אוכל, לא הייתי אוכל על פי המסורת שלהם. כי אני מחזיק את המסורת שלנו וקבלת אבותינו זכרם לברכת חכמי אשכנז. I go by my tradition, שהייתה התורה ירושה להם אבותיהם, אמות החורבן, וכן קבלת אבותינו רבותינו בצרפת, יותר מקבלת בני הארץ הזאת ספרד. So he basically said that you depend on the tradition, that's the Shuta Rama Kuv Kavav also said the same thing. There is a discussion about tavas, about peacock, and about different type of turkey, but the bottom line is again the Zivchei Tzedek, Perek Bet Halacha Yudalet said that again because of the issue of Masoret, we do not eat them. And as we said many times, when one is not sure, should ask a prominent posek.